My name is Andrew, and I'm one of the pastors here, and you're joining us for our last sermon in our series called Lessons from a Lockdown, and we're going to be reading from the Bible. Just pause for a minute. Yes, this is the Bible, and we're living in a world that is so shaken at the moment, but this is our solid foundation. I want to encourage you, put your trust in this book, put your confidence in this book, and I pray that as we look at this book today and read this passage, you're going to get so much from it, because we're going to be covering two big lessons from a lockdown. And here they are, two massive life lessons on two big issues. And it's about contentment and provision. Did you get that? That's what we're talking about today. And those two things really are so important in everybody's life, the world of contentment and the world of provision. So I'm going to jump in. I'm going to start reading the first half of our passage from Philippians chapter 4, and it's from verse 10 down to verse 13. Here we go. Paul says this, "I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you, the church, renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want." Look at this, everybody. "I can do all this through him who gives me strength." How incredible is that? If you're taking notes, you can write this down, type it in somewhere. In a lockdown, discover the secret of contentment. That's it. Write that down. Imagine if we could come out of this lockdown having greater contentment in our lives. You see, the biggest disease of our generation is disease. How many people know that to be true? We are just not content with our lives, with ourselves, with our bodies, with our spouses, with our world. You see, people live in one of two tents. They either live in the tent of content, or they're living in discontent. And this is what I've noticed in life. Sometimes the tent of content is a lot smaller, and the tent of discontent is huge, and it has so much in it, but it doesn't always offer people what they're looking for. I think Benjamin Franklin put it best when he said, "Content makes poor men rich. Discontent makes rich men poor." Paul was in a prison. Let's remind you of that. Paul was in a prison as he was writing this letter. And I believe that he had discovered a vaccine, not for COVID, but he had discovered a vaccine for discontentment. And you're going to see this in our further passage today. Look at this here. This was like his vaccine. He said, "I can accept all things" in verse 11. "I can do all things" in verse 13. "And I have all things" in verse 18. It got right into the heart of who he was. But let's break up the passage that we just read. And Paul says there in verse 10, and there's going to be like four C's. Are you ready for them? He talks, number one, about concern. "At last you renewed your concern for me." I believe that having concern for other people is a key to contentment in life. I'm going to show you a video clip here, and it's from my friend back in Ireland, and some of you will know him. His name is Aaron Boyd, and he wrote that incredible song, "God of This City," and recently his father was ill. Well, do you know what? I'm not going to tell you the story, because I'm going to let James Corden, he's going to tell you the story from his show just last week, when something really happened to that was just incredible to Aaron's parents. Just watch this clip.
Moving on, here's a story all the way from Ireland. 76-year-old Wes Boyd was admitted to hospital showing signs of coronavirus. He was held there for a week, and his wife Sadie was beside herself, having never been away from Wes for that long in their entire 50-year marriage. When Wes was thankfully released from hospital and had made a full recovery, their son Aaron picked him up but didn't tell his mother. He just said he was stopping by to get a grocery list. Instead, she got the surprise of a lifetime.
She doesn't know.
Right.
Oh, aye.
Do you need anything? I'm going to the store if you need anything. I dropped a wee thing off just there. There he is.
How beautiful is that? Can you see the genius in that moment? That when you start showing concern for someone else, I believe not only does it bless them, but it raises just like a new level of contentment in your own life. So in verse 10, Paul talks about concern, but verse 11, there's two C's here. It's called content and circumstances. He says, I have learned to be content, what? Whatever the circumstances. And the Bible was written in Koine Greek. And the word content is way bigger than just what we understand it to be in English. Back in that original language, when Paul said the word content, this is really what the church was hearing. Self-sufficient. Content in the sense of being, listen to this, satisfied, living in God's content. How good. God is totally content. He doesn't need anything from any person. And what we do is when we enter into that, we enter into the very contentment of God. And it's an inward sufficiency, and it's every bit as valid in the low times, in the times of suffering, as it is in the high times of like temporal prosperity. And Paul is just saying here, do you know what? I've got this inside of me. I have tapped into godly contentment. He goes on in verse 12, and this is the word, we're going to use the word code here. He says, I have learned the secret of being content. And I just stop here for a second. Before we talk about content again, look at this. He says, learned. I just love it. I'm learning the secret. I didn't get it the first time. How many people out there had to retake a class at school? Well, there's a few classes I had to retake and retake and retake and retake. I got like a master's in retaking stuff. I mean, it took a long time. And I love this with Paul. It wasn't just like a spiritual gift that was imparted, this whole idea of contentment. It was something that he needed to learn. I don't know if you've been walking through an airport. How many people can remember those things called airports? Remember the day we should take flights? Yeah. And you saw one of these here. I call it a brag tag, okay? A brag tag. And it's the person who's like part of the platinum club. And as soon as they get on a flight, they don't turn right like me and the rest of the peasants. They turn left. Why? Because they're a million miler. And I've looked at their brag tag and I've thought sometimes, you know what? I would love that tag. But then I think to myself, I wouldn't like to fly those miles. I don't care where I'm sitting on the plane. I don't want to do a million miles, people. I'm happy with my feet on the ground. You see, some of us, we're looking for all the privileges, but we're not looking for the process. And Paul, remember this, he's sitting in a prison and he said, I've come to that point in my life of where I have learned through life, no matter what the circumstances. I want you to see here, quite literally, we've created a graph here of like the highs and the lows. What does Paul do? It starts with need down here. And he says, I know what it is to be down here. And I know what it is to have plenty. And then I go across. I know what it is to be well fed. And I know what it is to be hungry back down. And then I know what it is to be in plenty. And then I know what it is to be in want. But this is the really key thing, everybody. He says this, I can do all things through him, through Christ who gives me strength. What was Paul saying here? He's saying, in life, you can either be a thermometer, like just read your circumstances. And so many of us, and I've done this in life, I've just like, all I'm doing is reading the temperature of my circumstances. And if things are down, guess where I am? I'm down. If things are up, that I go up. And Paul says, no, I've got something different. I've become a thermostat. I've connected to Christ and I've discovered a contentment in life, and things might be going up and things might be going down, but I have learned to stay in the middle and on the level. How did he learn this? This is so important. Verse 13, it was by being connected to Christ. He said, I can do all this through him, not through me, not by being more disciplined, but through him who gives me strength. You see, the key to contentment is not a place. We'd all love to be in Maui right now. Yes, I know that. It's not a place. It's not a philosophy. It's not like digging deeper. That's not what it's about. It's not a place. It's not a philosophy. True contentment is a person, and his name is Jesus Christ. Imagine if we could come out of this COVID season having discovered really what it is to have a deep contentment in our life. Lesson number five is this. In a lockdown, discover the source of provision. I'm going to read on here in our passage today. And this is really quite interesting because Paul is writing to the church and he's writing to them. And this is the context, it's so important. He's writing to them about finances. He's a financial advisor, spiritual financial advisor sitting in prison. Verse 14 says, "Yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you only. You have always been generous. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid more than once when I was in need. Not that I desire your gifts." This is important. "What I desire is that more be credited to your account. I have received full payment and have more than enough. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice." Note that language as well. Pleasing to God. Verse 19, "And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus." I am so conscious right now that as I read God's word and as I read about offerings, sacrifices, generosity, and finances, I'm really, really aware that in the month of April alone, over 20 million Americans lost their job. Unemployment is now at 14.7%. So I realize there's a whole bunch of people out there, and like the number one thing in your mind is going, "Andrew, how can I be content when I don't even know where provision is going to come from?" This is why I said it at the beginning, everybody. This book, it's not the words of this Irishman. It's this book that potentially in your life can change your whole perspective. I know it's tough. I know that you are digging deep, but I don't think there's been a better time to discover what the Bible says about finances than right now. I don't think there's ever been a more important moment to get a fresh revelation on provision. So let's talk about this passage. You see, it's not talking about giving, and that's not where I'm going. This passage is talking about trusting. Who are we really trusting? You see, generosity is what keeps the things we own from owning us. How good is that? You see, Bob Iger, he was the CEO of the Walt Disney Company for 15 years. He said, "Anything that reminds you that you're not the center of the universe is a good thing." And a lot of us have been knocked off our own universe. We've been knocked off kilter. We're like, where do we really belong? And this is the moment where actually we're getting spiritually recalibrated and being brought back to God. This is important, everybody. Generosity, what does it do? It creates an account. It creates an account. You can write this down. These are important points. Verse 17, we're teaching you the Bible today. Paul said there, "Not that I desire your gifts." He said, I don't really need your gifts. "What I desire is that more be credited to your account." You see, this for me, I've been trying to grasp this for years, that generosity is not God's way of raising money. See, God doesn't need money. Generosity is God's way of raising people. He's raising people. And God, or Paul talks here about people having an account. Now, this is what I know. Church is not a business. Church is about people, and it's about loving people. But the Apostle Paul uses a bookkeeping metaphor. And one of the top commentators on the New Testament is a guy called N.T. Wright. And he says this, what's actually happened through their giving to Paul is that their own account, presumably in God's eyes, has received a healthy credit balance as a result. I think that's mind-blowing. You see, God is an accountant. Yes, God is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Alpha and the Omega, but God is an accountant. You see, what Jesus said on earth, he said, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Don't you keep an account of how generous you are, but just know this, that God is keeping an account. And when God sees what goes into your account, this for me is incredible. Generosity also generates an aroma. It generates an aroma. Verse 18, it says, the gifts you sent, they are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God. Some of you may know this, but I married a French woman, and do they know how to cook, everybody? I mean, when it comes to heaven, everybody, the Irish will be doing the party, but the French will be doing the cooking. They're incredible. And I remember the first time that I went into a grocery store in France. Now, everything in America is bigger except the grocery store. Those French take their food so serious. And I walked to the fresh fruit produce aisles with my mother-in-law. And you know what she did? She picked up a cantaloupe melon and she started to smell it. And I thought, this woman is losing her mind. And I looked around and there was other French people. They were picking up the melons and they were smelling them. And I was like, what are you doing? What are you doing? And do you know what? She said, a really good in-season cantaloupe melon will have a fragrance off it. And before you know it, guess what, everybody? I was smelling the melons. Go to your supermarket, cantaloupe melons, smell them. They don't have a good smell. Do you know what? They're going to be hard inside. And this is what I have discovered in life, is that our generosity and the way that we use our finances, and we're teaching this today because it's in the Bible. We got to teach the whole word of God. That there is a smell of our finances. And it's either a stench or it's a scent. And the language of sacrifice is really interesting. The language of sacrifice is so, so important here. Because 16 times in the Old Testament, in the book of Leviticus, which describes to the Jewish people how they used to do their physical sacrifices, 16 times it says that when you sacrifice that animal on the altar and it's burnt, an aroma goes up to God. It's part of your worship. And God, either he detects through his divine nostrils, isn't this hilarious? Through his divine nostrils, the stench of stinginess, or he detects the scent of a pure sacrifice. You see, Jesus noticed this too. There's what people call it, the story of the widow's mite. Back in the day, a mite was just like a little penny. It was just so small. And this is what it says in Scripture. Look at this with me. It says, as Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. Very interesting that Jesus is watching people during the offering time. He also saw a poor widow, one of the most vulnerable people in society, put in two very small copper coins. Truly I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people give their gifts out of their wealth, but she out of her poverty put in all that she had to live on. You see, at this point, Paul's not talking about the amount. You know what he's talking about? He's talking about the aroma. That's what Jesus had taught through that woman, the widow's mite. It's not about the amount, because right now you're probably sitting there and you're going, Andrew, I don't know how I'm going to survive next week, next month. I can't see a financial future. All I'm saying is, and what I believe the Bible teaches is, that don't let this world and the outer circumstances really cut in on you, kill your contentment and kill the heart of generosity in your life. And I got to say this to you. Bayside, you're some of the most generous people in the world. It was just like last Wednesday night that we had this special night where thousands of people got on a Zoom call and we were given an update from the church. And we put it out to you that there was a lot of people in our local area, children that didn't have Chromebooks, children that didn't have internet access, children that weren't having an education at this time. We put that out to you. And guess what happened? You guys gave $250,000 so that children in our area could have an education. Do you know what happened at that moment? It wasn't one person that gave all the money. It was hundreds and thousands of you. You all got together and you all gave a sacrifice. And the aroma went up to God. And I think it was like a rose garden. It wasn't just like one big flower that smelled so good. It was all of us giving even the smallest gift to larger gifts. And it all came together. And I actually believe that God looks at that level of generosity and those kids getting an education. And when he sees them sitting there typing and doing their homework on a Chromebook, it sends up a fragrance to heaven. Thank you for your generosity. And then generosity understands abundance. Verse 19, Paul says this, "And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory, not in the Bank of America, not in the federal holdings, but what? In Christ Jesus." Paul says, I can do all things through Christ Jesus, but I'm beginning to understand that God will meet all of my needs and God will meet all of your needs according to his riches, not in your own bank account, not in your retirement fund, but in Christ Jesus, there is the abundance that we need in life. Let me illustrate this to you. Back when we got married, Isabel and I, we planted a church. And it was in the city of Derry in Ireland. And you know what? We loved that city. We loved those people. But it was a church plant. And when we first met there, you know what? We didn't know a soul in that city. And our finances, not for week after week or month after month, our finances for years after years were just like so low. But we had the privilege of coming to California. Some churches over here, they put together, they paid for our tickets, they flew us to California, and they had us preaching. We were preaching at weekends, and we were also preaching at camps. We were out here for 3 weeks. 2 weeks of that was camps and ministry, and then we had a week to ourselves. We were in Southern California. And I only had a couple of $100, but four kids, everybody. How many people have ever been there? And I had to look after them for a week. Yay, SoCal, $200, four kids, yeah. And I was thinking, how am I going to do this? Long story short, I said to Isabel, we're back down in this area in Anaheim, and I just have to call a few people that we had connections with just to say and be courteous to say hi to them. She said, yeah, take a couple of hours, make your calls. I called one of my friends, and you know what? I was thinking I'm going to end up having a coffee with him. He wasn't even in the area. He was at an office in Texas. And he said to me, hey, where are you? I said, I'm in SoCal. He said, who are you with? I said, I've got Isabel and the children. And he said, have you been to Disneyland? And like the thought of going to Disneyland, $200, everybody, doesn't get you into Disneyland with four kids. And I said, hey, well, no, we haven't been yet. That's what I said. We haven't been yet. And you know what he said, hold on a minute. And he rang another guy and he said, hey, Eric. He said, I've got Andrew McCourt on here and he hasn't had the kids to Disney. How many kids do you got? I said, four. That's a big family. He said, get him six tickets to Disney. And a question came back and he said to me, do you like that California adventure? And I said, I think it's nice. He'd get them tickets to that as well. And then he says, have you been to SeaWorld? And I said, no, we haven't been anywhere. Get them tickets to SeaWorld and the Safari Park. Everybody, it was like a world tour he was putting us on. It was incredible. He gave us all of those tickets by lunchtime of that day and $600 spending money. My mind was blown away. I know some of you are going, praise God, praise God, praise God. Do you know what? God will meet all of your needs. But I've got a God I got a God, and He is so good, and He is so caring. Do you know what? He's a God of abundance. And I don't think God's driven by my grades, but He's a good Father, and He loves me, and He loves my children, and He loves you, and God is for you today. And I want to say this to you, and I want to say this to me. I want to come out of this COVID having learned the lesson that my true contentment lies in my relationship with Jesus Christ. And I can do all things through Him who gives me strength. And I want to know this as well. Not only that God is enough, I want to know that God gives enough. That He will supply all my needs according to His riches in Christ Jesus. I want you to take heart today, not from what I'm saying, but from what Scripture says, that God wants to give you a deep, Christ-centered contentment in your life. And also He wants to give you a contentment that's based on the knowledge that He will provide for you. The biggest provision that God ever gave for you and for me was in His Son, Jesus Christ. And it was through His death that He provided for us forgiveness for our sins. He was the ultimate sacrifice for us so that we could have true contentment in our lives, knowing that we're at peace with God. And at Bayside, we always give you an opportunity to start the relationship with God that will change your contentment, your provision. You know what? It'll change your past, your present, and your future. And if you would like to enter into that relationship, would you pray this prayer with me right now? Just close your eyes, pray this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, thank You that You are my provision, because You're the Lamb of God that was sent to this world to provide forgiveness for me. Jesus, I put my trust in You. I declare that I'm going to be content with You for now and for all eternity. Oh, be my Lord and be my Savior all of my days. I pray it in the name of Jesus.